Once again, let's check the sound, whether all the headsets are working properly and the, okay, thank you. So dear friends, right, so it was just a false start, a testing procedure, and now let's open our roundtable discussion. So it's a very great pleasure for me to see our visitors and our guests, although we expected to see more people. And so I guess that the weather, the cold climate, and the tough security prevented everybody, those who wanted to join us, to come here and take part in our discussions. Okay, so we are starting our discussions. And a few organizational matters at the beginning, how we are going to work, and then I will describe the reasons why we selected such a topic for the Gaidar Forum. We have six experts who represent Russia and Belarus, and also six experts who come from other countries, and not from Russia, not from Belarus. So we will first learn their views regarding scientific infrastructures, how such infrastructures are developing either locally or globally, and then we will request our experts from Russia and Belarus also describe their visions and speak about their views regarding the infrastructure, scientific infrastructure, research infrastructure in Russia. And then we can open the discussion. And so why this topic was proposed for the Gaidar Forum? Oh, sorry, one more point. Since we are quite few here, and so I believe that the entire procedure can be very informal, even if you have a great desire to ask a question, then please raise your hand. And since I am a moderator, then I will give you a chance to clarify something and to have you get that information that you would like. So we have 2 hours ahead of us. And so again, going back to the topic, why we're talking about open research infrastructure. Right now, we observe a revolution related to internet technologies. And why I call it a revolution? And from the start, our panel discussion should help us understand how this revolution is evolving. We know that the internet technologies gave new communication means to the human beings. And so we can coordinate our activities in a faster and quicker as compared to the previous times. And those countries, those states which we represent and where we live, they are have still retained their old infrastructures and old specifics. And now we see that lots of things are changing. And the scientific environment, research environment, is becoming more and more transparent. What do we see today? So today we can see who is doing what in terms of research projects. We see the citation indices. We see those publications, which make it possible to tell anyone who is the author, the original author, and who is has used some others' ideas. And so the new technologies now give us a chance to regulate those processes that we are observing, and the assistance from the public and private sectors and agencies is decreasing. And now we see this very interesting phenomenon, because today we can self-regulate our activities. We can do it now better than the government agencies, and it's easier for the governments because they don't have to spend huge amounts of money to support such research infrastructures. That's the end of my opening remarks, and I hope that I haven't spoiled anything for the panelists. And so let's start our discussions. And the first speaker is Cameron. So the first group of experts will be speaking English. And so those of you who would need Russian translation, please use the headsets. And the second group of experts would be speaking Russian. So Cameron, the floor is yours.
Thanks for that introduction. Thanks for inviting us. So I was given the task of starting at the top, as it were, to describe what it is we're talking about and perhaps why. And Sergey's given you a piece of that. I want to give you a similar story from a slightly different perspective. Because what we're really talking about, as Sergey said, is why the web and the internet changes the way we think about doing research and scholarship. So, I'll turn this on. So I want to start with these words. Each one of these words, open, scholarly, and infrastructure, are actually very difficult to define and actually very contested terms. They are what counts as scholarly, what counts as open, and indeed actually what counts as an infrastructure is a political question because it relates to questions of funding. So I don't want to try and define things. What I wanted to do was pose the question of why we care about it, why this conversation is useful, and why now? Why is it worth having this conversation at this point in history and this point in time? And the fundamentals are exactly what Sergey said. The internet changed the world in important ways that we're still working through, still trying to understand in many ways. The key to this is it makes it technically easier to work across boundaries, and boundaries include from within institutions to wider public, across disciplines, across geographical boundaries. But the key to this, and this is kind of important in this forum as one on economics and policy, is they change the economics of discovery. So what I mean by that is really a subtle point, but a really important point. We are moving from a world in which when you communicate research and new understanding, you need to find the small group of specific people with deep expertise, to a world in which it is possible and important in some cases to reach the very large number of people, a small number of whom might have the right piece of expertise. And this may be another researcher in your discipline, but it might well be another researcher in a different discipline. It might be a person who is not a professional researcher but has some expertise, a patient, someone who works in the environment, someone who works in government, or it may be a member of the public who just happens to know the right thing. This changes the way we need to think about how we communicate, how we share the outputs of research, and how we listen for the information and data that could provide insights into our research. And what have I done?
There we go.
So taking advantage of this, taking advantage of the opportunities, which, as Sergey said, potentially makes research cheaper, more effective, more efficient, more applicable, requires a shift in the way we think. And this means moving away from project thinking with time limits and defined goals and very specific audiences for our research, and towards platform thinking, by which I mean the provision of systems, infrastructures, that support scholarship and are open in the way that people can engage with them, to use them to do research and to look at research and to comment on research. So this platform thinking means making long-term commitments to things that have an open-ended mandate, that have a purpose that continues into the future, and that as part, central part of their thinking are designed to reach new audiences who may have information that is valuable to us. And again, that can be information about research, including the information from the research itself. And this is why we care about open access to research articles, about making data available, but also making the data about research available. But this shift in thinking also has some fairly profound challenges. There are actually, if we think about giving people, putting large amounts of money into some of these resources and making sure they're available for a long time, that has the risk of concentrating power and resources in the hands of a few. And part of the other story about this is that we need to ensure that innovation and experimentation is supported by a diversity of people and organisations doing research. But the real challenge is one of coordinating and funding these kinds of activities across national boundaries, across regional boundaries, and across political language and other boundaries that have traditionally made those kinds of conversations difficult, across the boundaries that make the conversations that require a set of translators in the back of the room for us to converse difficult, as well as the different politics of various regions and countries, and as well as the different funding systems that operate in those countries. And at the bottom of this is the fact that these systems, these platforms, for them to be used and useful, they have to be trusted. They have to be something that you can rely on, because if we can't rely on them, we won't use them. If we don't use them, they won't be full of the rich resources and information we're interested in. So I, along with my colleagues, Jeffrey Builder and Jennifer Lynn, wrote a set of principles that we thought were a draft form of how one might design and run these kinds of infrastructures. I don't really want to go into the details of these. You can read the paper. It's there at the link. But there were three sort of broad categories here. One was the question of governance of infrastructures and systems. One was a question of financial sustainability, and the other was a sense of community insurance. But again, these three are just really about trust. So these governance is about a community and users trusting how something is run. Ensuring financial sustainability is trusting it to be there in the long term, so that if you come back in one day or 2 weeks or 5 years, the information you've put in will still be there and that you can still use it. And the third one of these is a little more difficult to describe, but it's essentially the idea that if something goes wrong, either financially or from a governance perspective, that there is a way of dealing with that by forking the infrastructure, by being able to, if necessary, duplicate it and take it somewhere else. So this is about open source and open data and those kinds of things. So really what I wanted to leave you with is the idea that there are opportunities to do research, to manage research and look at research in much more efficient ways. They come from this real subtle and significant change in the way in which information is flowing. But for us to take advantage of these in a way that we can trust and that others can trust, and so that we have information, data and resources that collectively enable scholarship, and I would argue scholarship itself is about trusted information and how you can create trusted information, that that's really at the centre of all the arguments. And so that what it comes down to is how do we create technical systems, financial systems, and political systems that we can trust. And I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, Cameron. I apologize for not introducing everybody.
The experts come from different countries.
Information, I mean some short information about you, very short, okay? So Cameron is, professor is...
Cameron is professor from Australia, but he works in London and he deals with different issues of open infrastructure. Daniel is from Canada, Lynn is from South Africa, Cape Town. Vanderlei is from Brazil. Natalia is from Greece, representing a big international project. José Manuel Barrueco is from Spain. And Thomas Krichel is co-chair. Donald is from Canada, I said that. And Thomas Krichel is co-chair, and well, he'll be helping me.
Thank you. So my talk is going to be picking up on really the last point that Cameron made, which has to do with trust that if things go wrong, there'll be something there. I thought of calling this talk, It's Not Rocket Science, and you'll see why in a few minutes. I'm going to talk about the temptation, and this talk will be trivial to many people. It's certainly trivial to me, but it's something that I need to remind myself every project I'm on. So I'm going to start by talking about the big thing with the internet, which is its revolutionary potential. We're all engaged because we like that. And here's the person we really want to be. This is Douglas Engelbart, and he gave a talk, it's known informally as the mother of all demos, in 1968. And here's what he demonstrated in one show in 1968. The mouse, multiple windows, hypertext linking, word processing, dynamic file linking, version control, video conferencing, collaborative editing tools, computer-generated slides. Now, that list is my list from now. If you look at people talking about him in the 80s, they didn't recognize half the things that he demonstrated because they didn't exist yet, except in that demo. And there's this great XKCD cartoon about this, where he also gets credit for Leonard Cohen's Alleluia and the cat memes. So this was a revolutionary advance. This is sort of, when we think about the internet, I wish I could be him. But it wasn't infrastructure. It is our infrastructure now, but it wasn't infrastructure then. And actually, there's a kind of sad part to Douglas Engelbart's history, which is in the 70s and the 80s, he really was bypassed. And that's because the NLS, the system that he showed, although it anticipated so much of what we do, it was a coherent, complete system. It was a project that you had to take as a whole. It was very advanced, but he insisted that you work within it. And even as the new computer revolution came in the 80s and the 90s that led to the internet, he kept insisting, you have to use my system. And in fact, I've got that little circle around something which none of us ever talk about. He had a very strange kind of key piano thing that he could type really quickly with, which nobody has ever adopted. And that was part of this kind of, why don't you use my system? And so from the 70s on, his system was really, in a certain sense, left behind. So what this tells us is that comprehensive brilliance doesn't necessarily lead to good infrastructure. So what is infrastructure? And this is the thing that I find that I always need to remind myself about. The first thing about it is it ultimately needs to be generic or vendor independent. And that is to say that it can never be, it can be taken over, it can be duplicated, and it can be abandoned and survive still. This is something difficult for projects because we always want to add more. We always want to do the special thing, the thing that makes our project distinct from everybody else's. And you have to consciously fight against that. It also needs to be modular. Now, normally when we think of modular, we think of in things that we can add to our project. But actually, the most important thing is things that you can take away. The problem with Engelbart's project was he saw the whole thing belonging together, including that little keyboard that we never use. And he didn't want any parts taken away. It also, and this is another crucial thing, needs to be used and duplicated without negotiation. You may need minimal controls or protections against abuse, but you absolutely need to be open to unexpected uses. And I like to think of the road system like this. We have traffic rules, but anybody can build a road. And that's, in fact, an example of good infrastructure. And the last thing, and this is probably the hardest for all of us who are excited about the internet, is we need to focus on minimal requirements for what we need to do, not maximal requirements. This is something that in the humanities particularly we've struggled with recently because we've been so excited by computers, we started building large projects rather than small projects. And so this is why I said I wanted to call my talk, it's not really rocket science, or at least it shouldn't be. The point of good infrastructure is to build the left-hand thing, the launcher. If you find that you've also built a rocket, you've probably not built infrastructure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Say it again. Shine. Okay. Можем мы потушить одну лампу, потому что очень.
Can we dim the lights?
Итак, следующий Лин.
The next speaker will be Lynn of Woolfrey. Slides. Yes, slides are on the screen.
My name is Manola, and I'm representing OpenAIRE. So our two previous speakers talked about what an infrastructure should look like and how the internet has helped. And what I'm going to do is go over what we're doing in Europe, in the European Commission, about actually implementing such an infrastructure. So what OpenAIRE is a European Commission infrastructure, research infrastructures, that what our vision and mission is to foster the social and the technical links for open and reproducible science. And I'm going to go into a very high-level overview of what the social and technical links are. Some basics is that we are an ongoing European Commission project turning into a legal entity, so we're going to be an organization representing the European Commission, member states. And we have two aspects of the infrastructure. One is the human part, and the other is the technical part. Because what we believe in is, especially in the open science infrastructure and open scholarship, is unless you have the people that are there to support and to communicate with each other, you can have very nice services, but as researchers, as research goes, it's not going to get you far. So what we have is the human and the digital network. We have 50 partners from all over the EU plus Latin America. We have data centers in our group. We have universities, libraries with open access expertise, repositories, IT experts, and legal experts. Because the other part that we should all be thinking about when you're building all these small services and how they interact to each other are legal and policy aspects. And we can build nice services, and at some point we go to legal barriers. And this is important to have in mind when we're building all these services. What we started in OpenAIRE, we started as a participatory design, means that we are a distributed network, and I will explain a bit. Because what we see is in Europe, every country has different culture. Researchers have different behaviors. They have different policy frameworks, different technical maturities. So what we say is that one size doesn't fit all. And how do we go about going and supporting it? And the small services and the local support is what we want in our infrastructure. So what we say is that we have the different disciplines, local, regional needs, behaviors. We have diverse research information. We have publication. We have data. We have software, and people treat it differently. We have the long tail of science versus the big science. You have the CERN and the EBIs of this world that they're doing this huge amount of data. On the other side, you have the social scientists or the economists doing a project with some long tail data. And what we think the infrastructure and what we thrive for and we are aiming for is that we should have interoperability at all levels. And at all levels means the human, the organization, policy, legal, and technology. And what we think is that when you're building an infrastructure, and especially in such a diverse place like Europe, you need to have many stakeholders involved. You need to make it their own. You need to build a community around this infrastructure. So what we say, one of the first things that we do in OpenAIRE, and it's our backbone, we say it's all about people. So we have local support at universities and national centers. We have 33 what we call national open access desks, and these are 33 expert nodes all over Europe to help with policies, to help with technical alignment, and to do training and support on open science. But the human, putting it aside, then you have to do services, because the humans can do the training, they can do the connections, but you need services, because at the end, researchers, they are the lab, and they want to have services. How to enable open science and open scholarship is that you have to have trusted, secure, and robust value-added services, that they are embedded at all phases of the research, not only at the publishing, at the end when you're doing your publications or your publication of data, but all the way through the flow. And what we have found out is that you don't have to design all these big services. Even some small services that could take a programmer, a developer, somebody a week to develop, it could be huge. It could be embedded somewhere very intelligently, and it can make the difference. The other thing that we have found in our 6 years of operation is that it's not only researchers, is that the research community has different stakeholders. You have the universities with the data providers, you have the funders who give the money, you have the research administrators, you have the publishers, everyone involved. So you have to have services for all of this, not just the researchers. If you want to have a complete infrastructure, this is what we have to have in mind. So in OpenAIRE, what we do is we have services for all. We have services for researchers and research communities, data providers, finders, and third-party providers. And what we say is that these services are not all at the end. It can be, we facilitate the provision of these services at the university level, at the middleware level, and the value-added level, the top layer. And, well, the slides are not supposed to look like that. What we're doing is, we have dashboards. Now, what we're doing is, I think we are following what Daniel said, what Cameron said, is we're moving from a project to a service provision, to a platform, to a service provision mentality. And this is really hard, because when you are dealing with an infrastructure as diverse as OpenAIRE, the mentality shift is crucial. And last but not least is that we work for Europe. We have our 33 European countries are members. Now we have Israel. And we would like to see Russia, what Russia is doing and how we can work with OpenAIRE. But because research is not local, so even if we do something in Europe, then that's part of the whole picture. We have to work globally. And we say in OpenAIRE that what we would like to do is we would like to have coordinated regional networks around the world. And the regional networks, again, they can be either geographic, continent or countries, or they can be thematic, discipline-specific. But we need a coordination. And this coordination has to take place both in the human and in the technical aspects. So what we do with OpenAIRE, we have the synergies around the world. We work with various organizations through CORE, which is the Coalition of Open Access Repository, La Referencia in South America, Gyro in Japan and Mexico, and now with ICSU, which is the code data, /ICSU World Data System. We work with them because we want to interoperate, and we work with them on various levels, and this is something that you should have in mind when you're building your own systems.
Спасибо, Наталья. Yes. Чьи там темы прозвучали? Lynn, are you next? Next? Okay. Vanderlei, and after Lynn, you, yes? And
Yes. Okay. Yes, you can use my. Morning. So I run the open data infrastructure at the University of Cape Town in South Africa. Feel free to ask any questions. It doesn't have to be a monologue. So we've been around for 15 years, and we work in the research policy interface. What we do is we get government data, data that government's collected either through census or survey research, or as part of administrative processes of running government. And we check the quality of the data, and we prepare it, and we put it up online for researchers to use worldwide. And what we hope is that good policy research based on sound data will feed back to policymaking in South Africa. We also we also install the infrastructure that we use in many other African countries to encourage evidence-based policymaking. So what I've done is I've just modeled the work that we do. This is actually based on an open information sharing model, a standard. So I'm just going to run through it and discuss the infrastructure that we use in each stage. So as you can see, so what we do is whatever's in the gray square. Outside the gray square is data collection. So we generally don't collect data. We get data deposited with us. And then right at the end, the data-intensive research, which we support. We actually have a research department where we do research, but it's specifically on data, data quality research, data usage research. So we don't do, number one, collecting data, but what we do is we receive the data, and for that we have to set up some sort of data deposit system. We're in the process of designing a data deposit system with our module because previously we had to find different ways of getting the data, which is not optimal. You don't want people to email you their data. First of all, you don't know if the data is secure. We have received data sets with people's names and addresses in them, and that's not something you want to go over an insecure system like email. So the ideal for a data deposit system should be online self-deposit. So if you have a data set you want to give me, you should just be able to deposit it, and hopefully the deposit system will also have some way of capturing some metadata. We often get data sets that are lacking important deposit information like the date when the data was collected. So that's quite key. Then we assure the data, we check it, and if you're interested in that, you can actually go onto our website. I've modeled exactly what we do. We have the stages of actually checking the data for quality and also anonymizing the data. Then fourth, we describe the data set, that is, we create metadata. And for that, we use a free tool called Nestar, which is available online, and it's used by all the European data services. So it allows us to have, and it's based on an international metadata standard, the Data Documentation Initiative. So if I get, and you can export the descriptions in XML. So I can actually compare my description of my census data with the description of the census data from Zambia, from Nigeria, from various European countries. We store the data in a secure server, which is looked after by our IT department at the university. Then data discovery, we've got three different ways of discovering data. With our portal, you can actually do online analysis. It's very basic. It'll just give you aggregated statistics. You can download the raw data using the system. And then we also have a little room where we provide data that is potentially disclosive. For instance, has household GPS coordinates. So some people give us their data that is confidential, not sensitive, but confidential, and we still allow the researchers to use it, but they have to come to UCT and use it in a secure room. But that's about 10% of our data. We try and make sure that all our data is open. And then our system allows us to track usage. So we have a citation module. So each data set has a landing page. And on there, you can download all the documents, like questionnaires. You can download the raw data. And you can also see what other people have done using the data. And there's you, the researcher doing data intensive research on the right-hand side. So these are the tools we use. The portal we use, the platform for dissemination, is called the National Data Archive, and it's available. It was developed by the World Bank Development Data Group, and that's available free on the website. I can give you the links. The links are actually in here. And that's just a little screenshot of what it looks like. So you can see we have 341 data sets, and some of these are multiple waves of a particular survey. And then there's an example on the right-hand side, there's an example of the linked citations. So if you go onto the landing page of that data set, that's the census, our latest census, and you click on related publications, you can get a list of the publications and you can actually download most of them. The metadata editor that we use, free data markup software, and as I said, you can export your descriptions in XML and share them with others. In fact, the World Bank harvests our metadata to put on there. They have like a central catalog of data that's available around the world. They don't actually share the data, but they have the metadata up, and you can, and then they provide the links to our site. And this is our little secure room. So it's quite difficult for researchers to have to travel to Cape Town to actually use this, but this is a very small section of our data, and it's data that we've been given that is either very detailed, has very detailed geography, or for instance, we have some data sets, health data sets with confidential information. We still want researchers to use them, so we believe that all data can be shared in some form. And because we want the researchers to use good quality data and accurate data, and at some, for some projects, you really need that low-level geography data, we try and make the data available in any form we can. We also check all the data, so what they're using, they know, is high-quality data. So Cameron was talking about trust. So it's very important that researchers trust the quality of the data that is coming from you. So we've been, it's one of the things we emphasize very much. We do a lot of versioning of the data. So you know when you download data from our site that it's the latest version, and you can also see what has changed since the previous version. And so that's very important. We do have other data. In fact, most people prefer to get our government's data from us than from the government departments. And in fact, the government departments refer people to us because they know we've already done quality checks. Plus, we have an online help desk. So if you download data from us and you have queries, we will answer them within a day and help you to use the data. And that's my university.
Yes, Vanderlei, please.
Okay.
Wait a second, they will absorb your slides.
Okay. Good morning. I'm going to talk about a local development of an infrastructure in Brazil. And this infrastructure is a thematic network that's supporting the development of botany in Brazil. And so basically, we deal with collections data, we deal with the primary data, and the data providers are the collections curators. And so we develop a system to harvest all the updated data in the network. And then we do all the work, like helping like the curators of the collections to do the mapping of the data, such that this data can be automatically can be fed to the network. And so for that, our group is developing all the tools and workflows, not only to integrate data, but like to manage the data and to do the data analysis. And so basically, we are talking about a local infrastructure dealing with primary data, but also I will try to stress the importance of global collaboration, integrate like data from other networks and providing data in a free and open way. So basically, here, like you see, like the green are the botanists, is like dealing with their data and providing data that will serve to all. In addition to specimen data, we take a special care of some parts of this data, like the occurrence. Of when the place where the specimen was collected, and also like images of the specimens such that the community can do the analysis of this type of data. And so in addition to species names and occurrence data, and images from vultures, live plants, we add all types of layers of data like maps, graphics, we have like catalogs of names, like global catalogs of names, like Species 2000 Catalog of Life, the Encyclopedia of Life. And so based on all types of data, images, maps, we are developing like workflows, for example, to do the analysis of the biogeography of occurrence of plants. And basically, we're setting up all that like based on web services. In addition, we provide a set of tools to do like the data cleaning. So this network is continuously improving the quality of the data. And also, we provide tools to do automatic georeferencing. And also, we provide ways to see like for the users, any type of user, to see like the evolution of the network. What's the usage for what's being used, for what this data is being used. We are setting the base like for the Brazilians to do like cyber taxonomy, and also we provide annotation systems for somebody else like to comment on your data, and also like workflows to do gap analysis and biogeographic analysis. So this is the record of the evolution of the network. So we have like a manager. Every time that we have more data added, the following day, this data will show up to the network. So this botanical thematic network, we start like the special project, like for the thematic network 8 years ago. So by the time when we start like this thematic project, we had like 2 million records. And today we have like 5.5 million records and 1.3 million images. So that's very robust network that we can experiment like with this issue of integration to other global initiatives. See, here is the picture of the evolution of the network like in 2009, 8 years ago. We had like 48 data sets. Now we have 190 data sets from participants from every state in Brazil, plus 26 international participants, like the New York Botanical Garden, the Kew Botanical Garden in London. And so we are selecting which collections that are not in Brazil that should be incorporated to the network. So basically, this is a platform for the development of botany in Brazil. Talking about image analysis, we have like these image servers, like integrating all types of images, and we can do like all the analysis of the images, but also we have like workflows to do biogeographic analysis. And this is all open, and so we integrate all types of data like catalogs, names, and taxonomic relations from tropicals from the Missouri Botanical Garden, and we compare that with the Brazilian list of plants, and then we get all the data from data points, like from where those specimens were collected, from the Species Link Network, the Brazilian Species Link Network, and we integrate that to all data climate change from the world climate. And then we can have, as a result, you can, like, going through this workflow, you can have like the image of the model, and then you, the person that did that. Anyone can use like this workflow, and then can publish the model of the biogeography of this plant. And so we have a good set of about 4,000 models that were produced by 135 researchers. The importance of convergence of technologies, like the first map, like the green, is the Brazilian NREN. We have like this Brazilian NREN giving all the support, like to connect institutions and universities in Brazil. And then we have like throughout Brazil, all the providers, and most of the providers are university collections. And this network is linked to 26 postgraduate programs, like in Brazil. And so this is improving the quality of the research. And then we, in the third map, we have like the usage of the data from this network. So there's a conversion of, you know, science and technology. And basically, the impact of this network, here we can see the usage. Since we started the statistics, I think, I 1.6 billion records were used. So every day, about 1.7 million records of this network are being used, like, for botanical research in Brazil. And this was quite impressive to us. And if you look, like, at the yellow ball, at the down right side, see, the yellow ball is the size of the library. Yes, and the red ball is the usage of this library. So that's amazing, the importance of this structure to be freely and openly available. So it's about, like, the usage is about 700 times the size of the library. And in addition to quantifying the usage, we are also doing a survey, like a dynamic survey, every time that somebody else replies, that's shown like dynamically in the net, and about the usage. And you can see what for the data is being used, like for doing biogeographic analysis, climate change analysis, and also from where the users are, like from universities or research institutions. And one thing that's really striking to us, like the green, like in the first graph, like the green ball is the usage from Brazil. And the red is the international user. I think that stresses like the importance of local initiatives. And most of the users are from research institutions and universities, and especially students from graduate programs, so the new generation. And so this, you know, the users are giving a big impact to the network development, because all the tools are developed to serve like the users. And the impact of this network, when you see like the convergence of like the network development in the left side, you see the impact of this network in the international publications led by the Brazilian researchers. There is like a big increase of the quality of science in Brazil. Last, I think the importance of integrate like local initiatives to global initiatives. We see ourselves as a small local infrastructure having a big impact in Brazilian science, but it's important to integrate that like to global initiatives so we can improve our development. So thank you.
Thank you.
José Manuel.
No slides, sorry. So you may concentrate all your attention on me. Thanks. Well, I would like to focus my intervention in a specific part of the open scholarly infrastructure, that is the citation indexes. Probably one of the most important forces driving the scholarly community is the impact. Impact is the influence that the research outputs, the publications, have on a concrete discipline or...
Mike, okay.
Yeah, in a discipline or on the society too. And it is important at different levels. It's important at researcher level. The researchers need to know the impact of their publications, usually for tenure and promotion purposes. The importance of publications is also great for institution level evaluation carried out by the universities. And it is also important at government level to carry out an effective planification of the scientific policy. Traditionally, bibliometric indicators, like for instance the impact factor or the H-index, have been used to calculate the impact of the publications and the researchers. All these indicators are based more or less in the citations and citation counts. Of course, research evaluation is much more complex than citations. It should not be carried out only exclusively using citations. Citations should be complemented with other metrics and also with expert peer review and other methodologies. But at the end, citations are an important part of the research assessment processes. And in this sense, research evaluation requires the existence of citation indexes in order to provide current and accurate citation data. And what is the situation at the moment with citation indexes? Well, that all the six existing citation indexes are commercial products, are tool-gated resources. Probably everybody knows Web of Science, knows Scopus, Cival from Elsevier. They are products that are subscribed by university libraries all over the world. We spend a lot of money on them. Of course, we have Google Scholar Citations. That is a free service, but it's not open at all. We are talking here about open scholar infrastructure. Google Citations is not open, and they don't allow the distribution of the data, and also the methodology of the elaboration lacks transparency, and the quality of the data, well, is maybe not so good for research assessment, in my opinion. So, as far as I know, the only open source of citation data available at the moment is CITEC, Citations in Economics, which is the citation index that we maintain in RePEC, in the RePEC research library. This citation index has been around for 15 years. So it's a consolidated service. It's a well-known service between the economics community. At the moment, we have a database of around 25 million references with 10 million citations coming from around 1 million of source documents. We provide citation data at different levels, at publication level, but also at author or researcher level. We have 47,000 profiles for economics researchers in economics from all over the world. And we provide indicators like the H-index for them, the full scientific production of the researcher. Also, we have citation profiles at series level, journals and working paper series, providing data like impact factor or immediacy index with time series that go back to the early 90s. And we are going preparing also citation profiles for institutions in order to carry out evaluation of economic institutions. This is to come, it's not yet ready. So all this data is open in the sense that we make it available in a single data set in XML format. Secondly, everyone can take this data and make the implementation that that she wants without any limitation. So any limitation, it can be commercial or not. So in conclusion, in my opinion, citation indexes should be an important part of the open scholarly infrastructure in order to provide accurate citation data. Technology is there to create such tools. We have done it, and other disciplines can do it too. So I will invite the open access service providers to go ahead and implement this type of tools in order to increase the added values that they provide to the community. And to finish, I'm glad to announce that RANEPA is going to start a 3-year project to enhance or to expand our citation index to Cyrillic, to deal with Cyrillic characters, to deal with Russian publications that at the moment are excluded from our system. So we hope that in a few years, 3 years, we will have available a citation index for Russian publication, which I think is a good news. And well, this is our small contribution to the open scholarly infrastructure. Thank you.
Спасибо большое. Could you use your translation device, because now people will speak in Russian? Окей. Прежде чем вы приготовите задать вопросы, я хочу сделать маленькое резюме того, что мы услышали, потому что мне.
I first want to sum up briefly what we've heard by now. And we've witnessed a very interesting combination of ideas. Cameron told us what open scholarly infrastructure is and what its principles should be. Daniel spoke about infrastructures and different aspects of them, including the historical approach. Natalia told us about some more specific things. She told us about the Open Air project, which exists at an inter-country level. And this is a model of some scholarship infrastructure, although I'm not quite sure that it is really open. Possibly it's self-sufficient now, but not really open. Possibly we'll discuss it further later. Lynn gave us an interesting example of what is being done in South Africa when a service created in one country was used in a different country. Lynn told us about the projects of European Commission and their approach to open access infrastructures, our program Open Government, Open Community, are based on similar principles. Wanderlei told us about another case when they started collecting data for a herbarium in Brazil, they developed this project into a real-life functioning infrastructure that finds demand and meets the interests of users throughout the world from different botanical gardens all over the world. José Manuel spoke about a very interesting case story when such structural projects presented data for commercial organizations or replaced them. Previously, we in Russia used just commercial products and paid much for them. But now we see a case of an open access project, which is free, which we don't have to pay for. And people may get information on the citation index and use that information. This is a very interesting development, and so I think that the developments we see throughout the world are really very interesting for us. Now we open the floor for a discussion, and please take not more than 5 minutes, or preferably less. Now we move to the second part of our experts presenting the Russian reality.
Вопросы, пожалуйста. Я думаю, что вопросов не будет.
I don't think there'll be any questions. No, there is a question. I first want to introduce you, Vladimir Alexeyevich. Vladimir Alexeyevich is well known in our community. 15 years ago, he started creating a scholarship infrastructure for research centers of Russia. 10 years ago, it all ended in a failure. And what is your question now? I want to draw your attention to the following. In your introduction, you said that the development of this infrastructure has an effect on the development of science itself, and we need to introduce a more systemic approach into it. I think that this is an overestimation. Science develops on the basis of long-term projects, highly educated people, a high-quality level of education, etc. And so the question of the effect of this open access scholarship infrastructure on those time-taking, long-lasting processes is something vague. Surely the issue of the integration of data is relevant. This is what we need to do. But yet the influence, the impact on the development of science per se, is overestimated here. I don't see any references in the publications, present-day publication, any references to the impact of those infrastructures on the success of research. Surely it may have an effect on the governance of science, but this discussion nowadays on whether governance of scientific research really needs citation metrics, and we've always discussed and doubted that at our institution. why in general do we try to promote this open air and open access infrastructure to improve the life of science, of research, or to better distribute the money or improve scholarships for people or projects? I'll refer this question to one of the experts, Cameron.
Of open scholar infrastructure. So how it's, how we can, what?
So I detected, I think, two or three statements in there. One was the question of whether research is changing. So we've made some claims about whether research is changing. Also whether that's related to real improvements and efficiencies in research. And then I'm not sure I quite understood whether you were suggesting that we shouldn't be focusing so much on citations to measure the quality of research, or whether we already had enough data. If it was the first, I completely agree that we should be measuring and evaluating research in a range of different ways to explore different things. But let me come back to that that first question around societal impact and societal engagement in research. So I'll give two examples just to be quick. One is the largest resource for open access publications in the world at the moment, to the best of my knowledge, is PubMed Central, which is run by the National Libraries of Medicine in the US. There is some usage data on who actually uses those articles, and about 40% of those users are members of the broader public. That's showing that there is a great interest in research in the broader world. What we're starting to see evidence of, and particularly mostly in medical research at this stage, and where you would expect this to be more advanced, is communities very actively engaged, particularly patient communities, actively engaging with researchers and professional medical practitioners in looking at their diseases and conditions and how those are being treated. And there's some very interesting examples emerging, particularly amongst rare diseases, rare genetic diseases, showing that some of the information groups is in fact far better than that coming from the research communities, because they understand what their day-to-day experience is like. There are examples of communities involved in research, and like Galaxy Zoo and others like that, that you know are rehearsed a lot, so I won't go into those. But I wanted to sort of dig right into a question about how does engaging in this process improve the research in a university? I want to use a particular example, and that example is Queensland University of Technology, based in Brisbane. This was a university that was a traditional teaching technical university in Australia. Relatively low ranking in the 1980s and 1990s. It's shifted from that position to a position of world prominence, in particularly in some technological areas, and certainly to a leading position in Australia within those technological areas of things like robotics, communications technologies, and law and policy around copyright, for instance. That has been driven largely by the development of a repository of the university's content, which has raised its profile and its findability both for specific professional groups looking for expert advice. So because the university was easier to find online, they saw a very substantial increase in the number of lawyers, medical practitioners, technologists, companies, policy groups coming to them for advice, raising their profile and feeding on that, but also saw their rankings in various online rankings and search rankings, as well as things like the standard university rankings, rise because it increased their rates. It brings us back to the question of citation. So I think we're seeing cases where things are changing. the question you raise, which is an interesting one, is that systemic? Is it a broad-based change across the whole system? Or is it a specific change in specific cases? And I think that remains to be really worked out in detail.
Спасибо, Камера. As an expert, okay, Natalia.
What I would like also to stress is that we should not narrow ourselves in the academic world, because if you look at the OECD tables, then a lot of the ICT and risky research is happening in industry. And industry should have access to what the academics is doing. And this is not something that we can measure now, but we will be able to measure in the future. So we should go beyond our limit of our academic research industry. If you take US, Israel, Singapore, the research is happening more in industry than universities.
Daniel.
Just want to raise two slight other angles, and I think if I understood your question correctly or your comments, I think you raise a very, very important point about the idea of focusing on impact. I'm actually generally disturbed by the extent to which discussions of infrastructure, of citations, of open access are presented as good ways of, in essence, surveying science and proving that people have published better or more, or essentially reinscribing ways of controlling how science is done and sort of picking winners and losers. But there is an aspect to open science, to open infrastructure, that I think we sometimes forget. My background originally was in political speech writing. I'm a humanist by training. And one of the things I think to keep in mind is most science is paid for by the public, and there's an awful lot of heat is generated off of the work that we do that is not current, well, under previous systems, is not obviously captured. But by doing it in the open, what happens is we can actually generate excitement for the work that we do in the public. I have a graduate student of mine who calls this standing on the shoulder of trolls. And the idea is that in the past, we've tended to work in a very small community, and people have had to take it on trust that what we're doing is good. But I think the examples like Galaxy Zoo that we all know of, the Polymath Project, are actually extremely important. So in the humanities, the equivalent is the Wikipedia. Many of my colleagues refuse to work with the Wikipedia, refuse to assign it to their classes. That has always struck me as being completely bizarre, because we have a public that does as a hobby what we do professionally. And anybody who writes an encyclopedia article as a hobbyist when they come home from work is more grateful for what we do as researchers than beforehand. I know that I wrote a front page article for the Wikipedia that went through the whole peer review process. And in fact, if anything, I found that they were too respectful to me. When they figured out that I'd published a book on the topic, people kept pushing away anybody who had any criticism of me by saying, well, he wrote a book on this. And so that was the negative side, but the positive side was, in my entire career, I've never had anybody in the general public pay that much attention to what I've done in great detail. So I don't think we should throw it away. I think there's a lot of heat comes off of that work.
Thank you, Daniel. And just to... На русском. Забыл.
Other thing is that we should follow the time which is allocated to us, and now we still have a group of Russian experts to go through their presentations, and then because we have only 45 minutes left, and we've got to vacate this room at 2:00, and so I suggest that we'll listen to the presentations of the Russian group of experts, and then leave the remainder of the questions and answers till the end of this session, and so we can continue to ask your questions to all the panelists, but a bit later.
всякие разные тут сейчас вот идут моменты.
By the way, we have a couple of minutes left, so maybe while we are relocating our experts. But the answer you understood, that's that you cannot, let's say, expect to get all. So maybe things will not change in this country, but in the respective countries of our colleagues, well, things will be developing. It doesn't mean that they don't have any problems or challenges, but you see things are developing. So some of you have slides, and we have not settled the sequence of your presentation. So Dennis was the most active, so I suggest that he starts the discussion next. Mark, then Dmitry, Mikhail. Well, maybe we shall start with presentations, those of you who have slides to show. Okay. Right. Dmitry, if you wish, you may be last but not last in number, but not least. And so Denis Kosikov would be starting this round of discussions. And Daniel and Cameron said a lot about the necessity, the need, the necessity to have open access infrastructures. This is a widely accepted concept globally, but not so widely accepted in Russia, because, well, this is a question of repositories, data repositories, and the publications. In Russia, we see that academic and university repositories demonstrate just a very small growth, like 2% per year, although there are improvements for the better. And in universities, we see faster growth, which can be explained by the implementation of the top 500 and top 100 universities that is implemented in Russia. And so if such efforts and projects receive funding, then we see results, positive results. Most effective in the part of the open access are commercial projects. That's the electronic project of the electronic or digital library, cyber Олененко or Кибер Олененко. So essentially, this is a commercial project, although it fully supports the concept of open access infrastructures, contrary to another project or other projects that compete against the open access infrastructures. And these are social networks. Social networks demonstrate significant growth and significant penetration including the Russian science community. If library, for instance, we have approximately 50,000 active authors. They represent universities, approximately 40 listed in are registered in some social networks, and they also demonstrate quite an impressive set of tools which surpasses those tools which are provided by the open access infrastructure. So we see that there is a competition between commercial projects. Commercial projects very often are close-ended because we cannot use the data and the source data and the findings that they obtain. So on the one hand, they profit by the data which is provided through social networks and open access infrastructure. But on the other hand, they do not replenish such think tanks and data tanks, data banks with their own findings. In Russia, we do not have a profound heritage in terms of infrastructure, so it may be treated as a disadvantage or as an advantage. And we are present here at an economic forum, and we heard different models of development at different sessions of, and panel discussions of this forum. And so the thing is that we can repeat those mistakes and errors that have been made elsewhere, or we can opt for a shortcut and use more optimal itineraries and ways so that we could rely on the new technologies. And commercial projects, by the way, demonstrate a wider and more efficient use of lots of tools and means as compared to the open access infrastructures. So this possibility of taking a shortcut or make more efficient use of the best practices that we see globally, well, inspires optimism in us. One of the possible ways of development. And so the open access infrastructure and the social networks, anyway, they have owners of information. Such owners may interact with one another, and nevertheless, there's still some standard procedures and standard problems, like identification of authors, of specific dates of publications, the creation of joint repositories, and nationwide search engines, etc. And here, there are right now instruments which make it possible to eliminate such barriers, because these instruments, for instance, make it possible to create a joint or comprehensive repositories with all the catalogs and the protocols of research and records of research and all the initial data, which is very important for any author. So these new tools allow for promoting such open access infrastructures to a higher level, where we would not have several owners of its components, but we'll have a single owner. That would be odd. Denis is from Novosibirsk. Alexei is from Moscow. Alexei Minsk. Mikhail from Moscow. And Mac is from Yekaterinburg. So we see lots of Russian and Belarus representatives. While we're waiting for the slides, okay, dear colleagues, there's one important moment that concerns two aspects of research findings. When we talk about the raising, enhancing the accessibility of results and for such findings, we overlook another important point. The number of scholars and scientists that work on a certain number of problems certainly exceeds the number of scientific publications that we see in magazines, on the net, and on. And in order to confirm the results of a certain of a certain project, which is maybe just a routine work, a routine job, which is performed by this scholar, is just sort of a report that this work has been done, and it's well. So, an important step in the development of an open access infrastructure was this. Format of presenting information. Maybe the next stage would be to change the format of magazines. Maybe we should look for a new solutions that would help us select the core publications, or maybe not entire texts, but ones in segments of scientific texts in order to give them priority, so that such significant segments of texts and scientific publications are first and foremost available to the researchers so that they could trace the dynamics of research projects in this or that area. So it's up to us to filter all the publications and come up with the core of publications and research papers in specific areas. And so this will help us step away from the citation indices, or the number of citations that right now are used to assess the importance of this or that scholar, or the importance of that or that project. So we, when created this citation index, we looked to establish an instrument that would facilitate and speed up the search process regarding specific facts or findings. And right now, we have a wonderful research done by Bruno Latour, a Swiss sociologist, a social scientist, who studied for decades the life of science or sciences. And he discovered that lots of findings or facts which are published in some scientific articles and publications do not make it to larger publications or programs that are instrumental for the next step or next stage of research in this area. So strictly speaking, in terms of citation index, we can see only the actual data name of this publication, but we've got to also identify the core subject matters, areas of research, and link citation indices, maybe some other instruments, to such core targets. We could use, let's say, two additional aspects in order to acquire and to get a more accurate search results. So this would not only give scholars a chance to present their reports on their routine work on a daily basis, on a monthly basis, but also focus on our global research. Thank you.
Что не уступающие, то революционные всякие разные идеи, предложения очень приятно это слышать. Чувствую, времени нам точно не хватит.
Every new speaker proposes revolutionary ideas. Alexei, please. I'm Alexei Skalaban. I work at the Belarus National Technology University Library. I want to thank Sergey and Russian Academy of Sciences for the invitation to participate in this forum. I want to share the experience of Belarus with you and the open access situation in our country. Open access is part of open scholarly infrastructure. 20 institutional open access repositories have been set up by now. They are institutionalized university-based repository. 52 universities in our country exist all in all, which means that 40% of them have their own open access repositories. In Russia, this is a much smaller figure in percentage values. 250,000 documents are stored there. These are articles, books, monographs, etc. 90% of the information is in open access. there are some limitations on thesis texts, which can be read at the university premises only. As for publications in magazines, in open access publications, in 2015, 1,630 publications were made, 14% of which were placed in open access magazines. I don't know whether that's good or bad, because we have numerous publications in high-quality magazines which are available on subscription only. So 14% all in all are in open access, and that means that the rest are not openly available in our country. As for subscription, say for Science Director, it's available only at the Academy of Sciences, and that's the only place. Five national magazines are included into open access directory. And these are universities of these are magazines of our university. In 2012, we set up the repository of our university, 20,000 of documents in the database. We place there all that is published by our scholars and published by the university. You see the logos there. This is where we present our metadata. You see the names there. We think that this resource has huge demand. In a year, 1.5 million files were downloaded. We started with a new project, OAI Belarus, in December. We tried to unite the metadata of 20 repositories into one metadatabase, and by now half of the documents have undergone indexing. There are technical issues with presenting the files because each library described them in its own way, and we need to unify that mode of presentation. As for the infrastructure, we've set up the e-journal project. This is a joint project where we present space for scientific magazines, which are mostly in open access. But this is a commercial project targeted for the science community. And two of our magazines are in this database and in the Emergence Citation Index. And our plans for the future, creating a repository of research data. Experiments described in different articles very often are not reproduced further because the data is not really available. So we'll continue with that and with further digitalization of identification methods. Thank you very much. Now I give the floor to Alexei. Good morning, dear participants. I represent here the National Interfax University rating, and I'd like to speak about the following. What is the benefit of ratings presented in an open infrastructure? Such university ratings have their own specific audience. It all started initially with the wide audience of households, families of possible future students who are trying to choose the university for their career development and would like to choose the educational program. And part of those potential students will target at the academy segment, academic segment. And so it was necessary to present them reliable information on an optimal choice of those educational curricula and research and scholarly programs, plus to the academic prospects. In the past few years, we saw that the main audience of those university ratings has become the university administrators and regulators of education and science. Unfortunately, we witness the process when the formation of ratings for wide audience is converted into a segment of the economy, which we called marketology now. And we see the competition between universities, not for the high quality education, but for the ability to attract the most talented future students for high level programs and star quality professors. If we take into account only commercial products of evaluation of research, we, in the final outcome, will see that most part of the audience is beyond the scope of reliable information on the university activities. And thus is robbed of the ability to make a trustworthy choice of the educational or academic program. So we are for the possibility to open up the data to the maximum, the data on the publications, citation indices, and other aspects of university life. And we are trying to use open access data to the maximum in that type of scholarly metrics. Until now, in the infrastructure of open access, we see a bias towards social and humanities, social sciences and humanities. At our universities, for a number of years, for decades, we've seen the most intensive developments in basic sciences at the same time. Mark mentioned that very often we see that artificial intelligence systems can process scientific information and they undertake the major part of the effort of processing that information, and that improves the efficacy of work of researchers. So development of new methods of rating information, universities' ratings, also is improving, including artificial intelligence services. And for the development of artificial intelligence services, we need open access scholarly infrastructure. For the past 15 years, all those services were targeted at Wikipedia, and I partly agree with the criticism expressed by Daniel that you cannot always trust Wikipedia articles in everything. But until now, we don't have any other similar background which would be open access and could be used for artificial intelligence services development. And this infrastructure of open access provides additional strata of knowledge which will be used by artificial intelligence services and make them develop to a higher level of efficacy. And this will make the life of researchers and rankers easier and will make it possible to produce a wider range of ratings to the consumers. In conclusion, I'd like to say that in the Soviet period, the research infrastructure was based on some sacral principles. No time left. Well, thank you. I'll not speak about that then.
And Dmitry. So jointly with Michael, are you going to make one presentation or how you're going to? Will you take turns? Okay, let me start, and then Mikhail will follow on. And so I'm Dmitry Semichkin. I represent the Open Science Project, CyberLink, CyberLeninko. That's an e-library. We are working with a certain scientific infrastructure if we talk about libraries. Such libraries existed for centuries, and so were the main form of disclosing scholarly knowledge is a publication in a certain magazine and publication of a book, monograph, etc. Right now, life is changing very quickly, but we understand that this migration to a new mode of operation takes time. And so in Russia, we will be talking about such a gradual migration towards the new mode. So the 20 years of internet resources and the development of internet communication technologies brought us to the understanding of our need in open access infrastructures as far as knowledge and research goes. And last year, I remember a main idea that was formulated at this forum. So our success largely depends on the speed with which we share knowledge. And this certainly applies to open scholar infrastructures. And the European Commission, for instance, formulated specific tasks that must be obtained in order to speed up this scientific development. That's open access to knowledge and the construction or the creation of such an open access infrastructure. And today we heard lots of examples globally that are focused on finding solutions and on the formation of such open access structures or infrastructure. Maybe it's too early to speak about the global infrastructure, but we can speak about certain components, pillars of this infrastructure. And so in Russia, we assumed the major tasks. And so when we talk about this digital library, CyberLeninka, so first we collect data, we select materials which were collected in this library, we convert them into digital form. Plus, the second one is we check and clean the legal title regarding such documents. 75% of all the Russian and Soviet publications in this library, they already don't have any copyright, so they are for free access, and we don't need to be concerned about violations of the intellectual property rights. So it's easier for us to proceed with this work. But as we talk about some recent research, and in particular when it's conducted in the private sector, then certainly, well, this copyright and private and intellectual property rights must be observed very seriously, and we've got to find agreements with the authors. So in our electronic library, we have over 1,500 electronic publications. We have biometrics publications. It's among the top 100. As for the open license publications go, we are comparable to all the other repositories or DUAGE repositories in the world. So we've been working for 4 years, and we have collected open license publications, which in numerical terms is on a par with the collection that is provided by DUAGE. Since Cyber Leninka is organized bottom up, we have a problem regarding the completeness of data. And so for various reasons and for various causes, we still cannot attain 100% of completeness of data. And as I've said, that 70% of published articles are in open access, in the public domain, but the remaining 30% of that these are the high impact works and publications that everybody needs, but unfortunately they are beyond our reach, and it's common not only for us but for other countries as well. So this is not a local problem, it's a global problem, because for instance the precedent with this Sky Hub, when let's say thousands and thousands of articles are downloaded on a daily basis, and despite on the subscriptions, etc. So Google Scholar is and Stay Hub that provides full text, and Google Scholar provides links to such sources. In order to resolve the problem of data completeness, we certainly do have to rely upon some government regulation. And we know that in the Netherlands, for instance, the agreements are reached at the top level when the scientists are buying out their publications in order so that they could be presented and put into the free domain inside their countries, at least. And so that's something that should be done, but because this is a challenge. And a couple of words before I finish my presentation. That's the end of the 2016 was quite important and significant, because in Russia we have seen certain improvements, because, well, the president had approved the strategy of scientific and technical development, and I have noticed at least 10 mentions of the word openness, open access, and so the open of scientific data is formulated in this strategy as the main principle of government policy and in this area. This is very important, and for some time now we've been cooperating and interacting with the Ministry of Science education. Unfortunately, representative of this ministry is not present here today, but nevertheless, I hope to improve and expand our contacts next year. And Mikhail, Maybe I will go back to the question, who needs this work? Approximately 2 million people visit our library per day. We understand that, we cannot compare this number with the number of scholars. So it's just 90% of our visitors and readers are not scholars or researchers as such. And that maybe is the answer to the previous question. Thank you. And so before we start the Q&A session, I would like to summarize our second portion of the presentation. And so we will have time for the questions and answers until 2 o'clock, until 12. So at 12 sharp, we just have 8 minutes left before we have to vacate this room. Right. So speaking about this summary of our second part of discussions, so our experts discussed the existing infrastructures that are in place, and when we listen to our local story, but we see that, let's say, some structures have been installed 70 years ago. Well, maybe it's a joke and I'm exaggerating things, but I would like just to summarize and draw some conclusions. As if we compare the first portion of our discussion and the second part of our discussion, we see that we have lots of ideas. Well, that's actually nothing new, because we always come up with various ideas. But we compensate for the lack of some physical infrastructures or by very high morals and our enthusiasm. And so, we cannot really skip some historical phases, although we still do remember that some recommendations that you couldn't jump from feudal society to communist society, which is not really true. You cannot really skip quite natural phases of evolution. And blockchains, for instance. Well, it's a very popular idea, and we hear lots of recommendations about introducing blockchains into various infrastructures. That would simplify things for us. Thank you. And Ren Hicks, RANEPA. Konstantin Kokarev. So in the first section of our discussion, we heard about the migration from research projects to platforms. Maybe I did not understand it correctly, because, as a researcher, I don't want to set up any platform, because, let's say, I have a scholarship or a grant, I have my topic, and I want to work along these lines. So if we analyze other countries and other universities, so maybe I did not understood correctly what was going on. Let's platform and project orientation.
So that's exactly the point you make, is exactly the problem. We have spent 200 years learning how to work as individuals on very specific focused projects for our own glory and progression. And actually, while that works for a range of things, it is really problematic in a globalized world of shared information. And that means that some of us, not all of us, some of us will have to be engaged in building the systems on which we work to do those projects. And so you already have some of those platforms. The literature is a platform that exists that you do build and you do contribute to. The data that you share or use from government sources is another platform. But equally, there are a whole range of new possibilities and improved technical systems, some of which you've been hearing about, that have been yep. So, well, that was, yes, yeah, so.
Ivan, ваш вопрос.
Ivan, Ivan.
Opinion of our guests, and I will translate in Russian. We are trying to figure out what are the obstacles to open science, whether some sort of copyright reform is needed on the international scale, whether the policies of institutions should be changed. I'm interested in if you could assign the importance and value of changes on each level, on the international level, on institutional level, country level maybe, or individual academician contribution. Я спрашивал наших гостей, на каком уровне важны изменения для того, чтобы снять те препятствия, которые есть при открытии.
I think that's not an easy question, and maybe Cameron can say something. But I think what we've seen is that the researcher practices the way they work, they only change through services. So if you, and we tried that, and you know, it's services, infrastructural services take a long time. What has worked are funder and national policies, and then institutional policies. And international, no, you need an international coordination. But the policies, they happen at the national level. So if my funder is some Russian funder, I will do what they tell me to do. So what we see now in Europe is because the EU has the mandate on open access on research data and publications, now country by country are following. So if I'm a researcher and I'm taking a grant from the EU, I make sure that I make it open access. If I take from my Greek funder, I may not do it. So what we're trying to do is to align the policies, and then at the institutional level, because the institutions are too many funders and member states and countries and national policies are harder to do, but they're fewer. That's what I would say. I mean, I'm not sure how.
Cameron, would you like to add something?
I think the answer is probably too long. I wish I knew the answer, but maybe we can talk. Yep.
Yeah. We have one. У нас одна минута осталась. Кто-нибудь хочет сказать что-нибудь такое, что просто разум?
There's 1 minute left. Some final word. Bruno is the name of one of the experts.
You asked about the researcher issue, because I think, in fact, there's a responsibility on researchers. So I flip back and forth between the infrastructure world and an individual researcher. And I think the big change is what programmers call separation of concern. In the old days, when we were working off the internet, your project was both infrastructure and research. Now, if you're doing that, you're actually wasting resources. What you really need to do is decide which one you're doing, and then be quite restrict. If what you are interested in is your core research, then you shouldn't be building infrastructure. You should be using infrastructure. And if that's not what your interest is, if what you're interested in is how do I maximize the thing that I've built, if you're interested in generic things, then you actually need to stop thinking about your own project and instead think about how you can generalize it. And so I think the really big thing that has changed, and the people who are building infrastructure, I think, know this. I'm not sure that people like me as individual scholars realize it, is the extent to which you have to even more specialize. You're either doing the research or you're doing the development. Individuals can flip back and forth, but you can only do one at a time now in a way that you used to be able to confuse.
Thank you, Daniel. And я думаю, что, наверное, можно действительно.
Well, I think that is the conclusion. Оксана proposed that all other questions should be sent to our email address. We finalize our roundtable, but we are open for your questions and further communication. Oksana gave you the email address repository ranepa.ru. If you want to send a message to the experts with some additional information or details, do send us a letter. Thank you for being with us. And we hope to see you again next year. Bye-bye.